What if I told you that magic mushrooms may have evolved to fight off slugs, and that the first instance of psilocybin and fungi showed up just after the dinosaurs disappeared? We're talking 65 million years of mushroom evolution, extinction events, genetic mysteries, and an ancient survival strategy that's now only coming into focus. In this video, we're going to dive deep into the evolutionary history of psilocybin-containing mushrooms, how they emerged, spread their mind-bending molecules, and why they might have developed psilocybin in the first place. Stick around, because the story behind these mushrooms is more wild than the trip they send you on. So let's rewind. Way before Woodstock, before ancient Mayan rituals, before humans even existed, the genus psilocybe, the group of mushrooms known for producing psilocybin, first evolved around 65 million years ago, right around the time a massive asteroid slammed into Earth and wiped out the dinosaurs. This extinction event, known as the KPG boundary, turned the planet into a cold, dark, decaying mess, which just so happens to be the perfect playground for fungi. For years, scientists thought these mushrooms were relatively new in evolutionary terms, but a groundbreaking new study from 2024 flipped that timeline on its head. Researchers from the University of Utah and the Natural History Museum of Utah recently completed the largest genomic diversity study ever done on psilocybe mushrooms. They sequenced the DNA of 52 different specimens, including 39 species that had never been studied before, and they discovered that psilocybe has been around way longer than we thought. And here's where it gets really cool. They didn't just look at any mushrooms. They focused on type specimens, the gold standard examples used to define an entire species. These are the biological equivalents of a master copy. And because many of these specimens have been sitting in museum collections for decades untouched, this study gave us a brand new genetic insight into some of the rarest, most important psychedelic mushrooms on Earth. The analysis revealed something unexpected. Psilocybin didn't evolve just once. The compound we know today was likely synthesized at least twice, independently within the psilocybe genus. How do we know that? Because the gene clusters responsible for producing psilocybin show two totally different gene orders, split down the middle of the family tree. This genetic fork, a deep evolutionary split, happened around 57 million years ago, and it lines up with a shift in habitat. The early psilocybe species were likely wood decomposers, but over time, some of them transitioned to living in soil, and eventually to growing in herbivore dung, which is exactly where species like psilocybe cubensis thrive today. But let's back up for a second, because this raises one massive unanswered question. Why would a mushroom evolve psilocybin in the first place? Psilocybin didn't evolve randomly. It's a powerful serotonin analog, meaning its molecular shape closely resembles serotonin, the neurotransmitter responsible for regulating mood, emotion, and perception. When you ingest psilocybin, your body quickly converts it to psilocin, which binds to serotonin receptors, especially the 5-HT2A receptor, the same one that LSD and DMT activate. That explains what psilocybin does to us, but what about the mushrooms? What do they get out of it? Scientists have tossed around a few ideas. One theory suggests psilocybin may act as a chemical defense mechanism, deterring animals from eating the mushrooms by messing with their perception or making them feel sick. Maybe it causes vomiting or acts as a laxative, helping the mushroom spores pass through the animal's body before being digested. Enter the gastropod hypothesis. According to researchers, the timing of psilocybin's evolution right after the dinosaur-killing asteroid matches up with an explosion in the population of terrestrial gastropods. In plain English, slugs and snails started to take over. Fungi thrived in decaying post-apocalyptic world, but so did their predators, like slugs. Slugs are notorious for munching on mushrooms. They don't have the same central nervous system as mammals, but they do have serotonin-like receptors. So it's possible. And this is what the researchers are now testing, that psilocybin evolved as a slug repellent, not to make them hallucinate, but to mess with their neural signaling enough to keep them from eating the mushrooms. In other words, magic mushrooms might have not evolved to expand consciousness. They might have evolved to survive the slime. Researchers are already setting up feeding experiments to find out whether slugs avoid psilocybin mushrooms. If they do, it could totally change how we understand fungal evolution and give us new insight into how powerful chemicals like psilocybin evolved in the first place. And here's another twist. Psilocybin didn't stay locked in psilocybe. The study found evidence of horizontal gene transfer. That's when genes jump between unrelated species. Psilocybin genes appear to have jumped into other mushroom genera up to 5 separate times, between 40 and 9 million years ago. That's like mushrooms sharing the secret recipe for psychedelics across different evolutionary branches. But the implications go way beyond evolutionary curiosity. If psilocybin is a compound that evolved multiple times, in multiple ways, across multiple mushrooms, then there might be a lot more chemical diversity out there than we thought. Different species might produce slightly different versions of psilocybin or related compounds with their own unique effects. And that's huge for modern medicine. Because here's the thing, psilocybin is currently being studied for treating PTSD, depression, addiction, anxiety, and end-of-life distress. Clinical trials have shown major promise, but what if the best version of psilocybin for therapy isn't even the one we're studying? That's what mycologists like Bryn Dentinger, the senior author of the study, are thinking. If psilocybin does turn out to be a legitimate breakthrough treatment, then studying the entire genetic diversity of psilocybe mushrooms isn't just an academic exercise. It could lead to new therapeutics that work better, faster, or more safely. That's the power of biodiversity, and that's why studies like this matter. Think about it. All of this genetic data came from museum collections, dried mushrooms stored in boxes for decades, maybe even 100 years. These are specimens gathered by explorers, naturalists, and scientists from every corner of the world with no idea what future value their work would have. And now, their collections are helping us unlock the deepest mysteries of the natural world, one mushroom at a time.